Yes, guys, and welcome to the Sunderland vs Derby match review. So Sunderland sit nicely, sweetly at the top of the Championship at the end of this evening, being Tuesday evening, after a 2-0 victory over Derby at the Stadium Atlanta. Of course, I'm feeling massively different as to what I was in the previous video. Of course, that was off the back of that sort of gut punch of a defeat against Watford over the weekend. So we needed a response, and it's always good that when you get those defeats, it's good that you've got a game right around the corner. It's good that you get a midweek game, so you've got an opportunity to quickly turn the tide. You know, sometimes if you have a defeat and you linger on it for too long, you've got a full week to just linger and look back on all the shit that happened on the weekend prior. It can really get in your head. So it's good that we had only a couple of days later, we're here against Derby. But the thing that really made me happy about tonight's victory is, you know, going into the game, Derby, they haven't won away from home. We've won every home game. This is absolutely the kind of banana skin that we wouldn't have won last season, or at least we would have dropped points, particularly in the manner that in which we played the game. There was definitely some level of game management in this one. You know, this is absolutely a game where I believe last season, you know, we went 1-0 up just before half time. I 100% thoroughly believe that this is a game last season we would have either drew or threw away all 3 points in last season if this was the case. But the game management was different. We approached the game differently, and that's what I'm so pleased about. And it wasn't pretty towards the back end of this game. It weren't pretty at all, but we just have to ride the wave sometimes, and that's just what a bit of game management is, not just, you know, last season. I think if we weren't a goal up, we'd sit back at home rather than giving yourself a bit of a cushion to sit back on. We'd get that first goal, sit back, and we'd ask for pressure, and that's where we'd always concede, and that's where we'd always drop points, and we didn't in this game. We made sure we had that bit of a we had them at arm's length, we had a bit of a cushion, and then we sat back. And yes, it weren't pretty, but we sat at the top of the league, and I don't give a shit. I don't give a shit with the last half an hour weren't pretty. We got 3 points, we're top of the league. How can I possibly complain? And as a Sunderland fan, if you're watching this, hit the like button if you are buzzing that we're top of the league. But we'll get into the review, we'll get into the game, and we went unchanged from the team that did get beat against Watford, which, to be fair, as much as I know a lot of people wanted Dan Neil dropped, I know I gave him a lot of stick in the last video, and I think rightly so. I will call a spade when something's bad. I'll say it's bad. If it's good, it's good. Whoever you are, how good you are, I know Dan Neil's a fantastic player, which is what I said in the last video. However, there were just certain parts of his game that obviously I had issue with, so I brought it up in the video. He was improved tonight. It wasn't perfect, but he was improved. But yeah, we did go into this game totally unchanged. And the opening 5 minutes, it was actually all Derby. They were really targeting Serkin's side. And I thought, and I sort of kept note of Serkin, because the opening 3 minutes had three sort of contributions, if you will, to the game. His first one, it was meant to be a little give and go with, I think it was Job. And his pass back to Job went straight to a Derby player. Next time the ball comes to him, miscontrolled it, and he went straight out of play. And his third inclusion, or his third contribution, should I say, is Wilson on that right-hand side there, right back on the overlap. He just walked past him, ate him for dinner, and it was so easy. And that was that one chance in the entire first half, really, where he took on Serkin, got to the byline, pulled it back to the striker. It might have been Yates, and I think it was blocked, and it went wide. But it was a very good opportunity, and I thought, Serkin's going to have a mare here. But after that sort of 5 minutes, weathering the storm, well, I say storm, maybe mild turbulence would be the best way to put it, because they just put a few balls in the box without really testing us too much. We started to gain control, and their press completely dissolved within 5 minutes, and they started to sit back, and then we controlled the play, and we were really, really going for it, and that was nice to see. And at times we're probably guilty of trying to force it a little bit when, you know, we've got plenty of time, and you try and force it, and you just needlessly give the ball away. But in large, we look very, very good with some decent passing football. A lot of the play went down Mundell's way, where we try and take on his man. He was probably a little bit guilty of taking on his man and then wanting to go back and do it again. Isidor, for me, looked absolutely outstanding. He looks like a proper striker for me. Some of the runs that he was making off the ball, if you keep an eye on him, he might linger offside for a minute, and it's so intelligent. He'll linger offside, so the centre-back's thinking, okay, what's he doing? We'll let him go. And then he'll just come back onside as the ball is played his opposite way. So he can curl his run, and he's got this pocket of space, and he was making that intelligent run time and time and time again, and no one was giving it him. We'd be us driving forward with Job or Dan Neil or Chris Rigg. We'd just persistently give it out wide to Mundell, and he was through, you know, to slip it in. And he's got a hell of a pace. Sorry, he's got some pace on him, Isidor, and we just weren't slipping him through. We did it once in that first half, and he managed to just take away from his man, but his last touch were a bit too heavy, so when he eventually did get the strike, he lashed it a little bit, and it flew wide, but he was making that run time and time again, and a couple of times he had to make chances of his own. So, yeah, like I say, a lot of the time, Mundell was getting on the left-hand side, and then he would go for goal himself, and it was almost a battle of the wingers. Roberts, for me, on the right-hand side, he was a little bit disappointing in that I don't think he really asked any questions at all of their left-back throughout the entire game. He didn't touch the ball until, like, the sort of 10th minute, and then sort of get the ball, and he'd have a little bit of link-up play with Hume, a couple of little passes here and there, but he really wasn't asking many questions of him, in my opinion. But, yeah, Mundell, he was doing a lot on his side. He still created a few chances of his own, as I say. But because Isidore was getting so frustrated and making these runs and no one was giving it him, because we did break a handful of times. I think it was one time when Chris Rigg come forward and he basically either had the choice of Mundell or Isidore, and he's given it to Mundell, and then Mundell could have slipped it across for Isidore, but he's gone for goal himself and missed. But it probably would have been wiser for Rigg to originally give it to Isidore. But because he was getting so ignored so many times, you could see him flapping his arms all over the place. And I was flapping my arms because I was screaming for us to give it him and we just weren't. So after about the sort of 35th minute or so, I noticed that he started to come deep. He basically gave up on all these runs because no one was giving it him. He started to come deep, but typically in good old Sunderland fashion, as soon as he started coming deep, Mundell, who was refusing to cross the ball prior to that, he got it to the bar a few times, and I think once he gave it back to Serkin, he puts a ball in, and there's no one in the box because he sort of give up on his runs, and he's sitting on the edge. So I think it's just, I think in time that that wavelength will improve. But that was very, very frustrating to watch Isidore consistently make these brilliant runs and everyone's just fucking ignoring him. But, yes, it was a load of little nearly moments here and there. Mundell was striked, Isidore with half chances. And then a moment of absolute magic. The absolute thunder bastard that Job provided was 100% goal this season so far for us. And what a goal it was. They were trying to play it in the middle of the park, the Derby. Loose pass, finds Job, takes one touch, then another, 25 yards out, and just pings it across the keeper into the top left. Absolute phenomenal strike, and it's exactly what we needed in what was a really scrappy affair at times to make it 1-0. And we just kept on going from there, really just peppering him, really trying to find that second goal, and we didn't quite get it before half-time. But as I say, second half starts, and last season, I think this is where we would find ourselves sitting back and just allowing the opposition possession and asking for pressure, and that's when we would concede. But we didn't. We kept on going. We looked just as lively as we did in the first half, going for it, and we did get the second goal, and it was Wilson Isidore, and I'm so happy for the lad because he looks so good down the middle. It just looks like he has a lot more to his game than Mayenda, who, don't get me wrong, had a great start to the season. But this just gives a little bit of something different. His runs off the ball are so intelligent. He's absolutely blistering quick, as I say. But this time, Mundell does get it to the byline really, really well. And this time, he does give it across goal. And there is Isidore. He's running across his man. Similar-ish, but on the opposite side to the last goal he scored against Watford. Gets across his man. He could have even been given his own goal in the end. I'm not entirely sure. But it was pinged across goal. It looks like Isidore beats his man to it first and knocks it into an empty net to make it 2-0. Now, as soon as that second goal went in, I'm probably going to be a bit greedy, but I think Derby were there for the taking. We could have just kept on going and going and going, but we did kind of sit back a little bit at this point. I don't know whether this was a Regis tactic, which is understandable in terms of game management. He's got that cushion, as he alluded to at the beginning of the video. So just sit back. There's no point in throwing everyone forward and trying to take the piss. Just get away with the 3 points. But it does make for a very difficult viewing when, you know, you just go 2-0 up, you're buzzing, and then it's a sort of 60-minute mark. And to be fair to Derby, to give them credit, it weren't just a case of us simply sitting back. They did ring the changes on about the hour mark. They put 3 attacking-minded players on, and that did change the game a little bit because they had a lot of energy in that final third out of nowhere. But we did sit back. We seemed to get a lot more sloppy. The tempo dropped. But yeah, it felt like we just kind of conceded possession almost purposely, which, again, it wasn't good viewing, but it got the job done in the end. Pervader come on, Reesing come on, and Brown come on, who was come on off the bench. Good to see Brown back. He looked lively, he looked sharp. Pervader, I feel so sorry for him because he come on, and I know he had a cracking season last season for Sheffield Wednesday, and I know why we brought him in. He's a tricky player, he's a clever player, and I think a fully fit Pervader is a very valuable asset in this league. But every time he's come on, he almost looks a little bit like a sort of player that will stick out like a sore thumb in like a five-a-side. You know what I mean? With a nice little flicking trick here and there, but doesn't seem to have that fitness about him. And he went over on that right-hand side. a couple of times. He tried to drive forward. He might take on one man, but then he really tried to force it because you can see he is so unbelievably eager and keen to do well. And he'd run straight into trouble, or he'd do one flick which was good, and then he'd sort of panic and he'd just try to pass it straight or try and force the pass, and it'd go nowhere. And then within, I think, 6-7 minutes, I could see him in the corner. He was holding his, I think it was carved his hamstring maybe. And then after a few minutes later, he got pulled off, which is such a shame. You can see he's just desperate to do well. And we can't let him get his head down, you know, to try and support him. But he's really, you can see he's just so keen to do well, and it just isn't working at the moment for him. And this is just another injury to the list. And he has, this is the risk you get with him as well, because he has had a list of injuries in the past. But when you get the best out of someone like Pervader, you've got a really good player around, as I say. So it is a massive shame. So Watson come on, and I tell you what, as much as I say Pervader could be a valuable asset, Watson looked outstanding, as he did against Watford as well. He come on at a difficult time against Watford as well, did Watson. And Watson had those sort of Jack Clark-esque traits where he just cut in from left to right and drives at defenders. And he did that on the, tonight, on the right-hand side. He cut in, he drive down the middle. A couple of times he's taken his man 2-3 times, and he would find a man, but sometimes it might, I think, maybe the wrong man. Maybe he should either keep on going, or there was someone a bit further forward, he could maybe try and slip in, but he played a bit safe. But he was incredibly confident on the ball, looked really sharp. He was just gliding past players. He should have maybe gone for a shot at one point. He did, like I say, coming from right to left, took on one, took on two, had a bit of space, maybe hit it with your left foot, but he kind of held up the play and then give it to Mundell, and then kind of just let the attack die a little bit. But he looked so bright, as Watson, and I can't wait to see more of him. And I think now that Pervader has sadly picked up another knock, he might get a bit more in terms of not just coming on with 5 minutes left. He might come on with 20 minutes left, 15 minutes left, which, you know, to try and get more minutes in his legs, which would only benefit him and us because he looks very, very good. But yeah, they really did throw the kitchen sink at it in that last sort of 20, 25 minutes. It was just cross after cross. And to fit a lot of their crosses, they had plenty of set pieces, and they were really, really poor, you know, thankfully for us. But there was some goal mouth scrambles where they arguably should have at least got a goal back. Pato, you know, stood his ground a couple of times when there were goal mouth scrambles. But we saw it out. 2-0, top of the league. I can't complain with that. You know, fair play to Derby. They did throw it at us a little bit towards the last 20 minutes or so, as I say. But they just didn't have that little bit of quality that they needed. And we come away with the win, top of the league. And now we have, you know, 3 more days. And now we have Leeds at home as well. So it doesn't get any easier. Again, under the lights at the stadium alight. It may just say that light show, by the way. I don't know what any of you guys think. I'm going to say no comment. But there was a light show at the stadium alight, which, again, no comment. Let me know in the comments what you think about that. But yeah, come on. Get in. Top of the league. We need to smile tonight. Make the most of it. Hit the like button. Get in, Wilson. I love him. I absolutely love him. But let me know in the comments who your man of the match was. Mine was probably Wilson. Could you have gleaned that from me screaming Wilson? But anyway, if you enjoyed, hit the like button. Take care. Stay jammy.